Hello YouTube. Today I got another crab video for you, and I let a little bit of a teaser in my Discord as to what it might be. But if you're looking at the stream title, I'm sure you already know. Today we have a phoenix. The phoenix is a little bit different than the Rev, Neg, and Moros in that it uses missiles rather than using guns, and so that means the properties of how it fights is slightly different, and it functions just a little bit differently than the others. Why aren't you reload on the rage? There we go. It's like, why aren't you just reloading? But we're gonna go ahead and run a crab beacon today for the video, and it should take us about 25 to 30 minutes. That's what the last one, this is my second attempt to record this video. The first attempt ended in a failure because my software had issues, and hopefully the software is working right and we can actually get the video out properly. But I tried to do my first impression with the Phoenix in an actual video, and I'm just going to say that I am very pleased with the performance of this ship. It's fit very similarly. In that, well, not really similarly because it's a missile ship and shields, but much like the Rev, its ship bonuses, what we're starting with as a base, it has a 5% bonus to cruise, XL torpedo, and torpedo damage. We have a 4% resistance bonus, just like the Revelation has. And we actually have a missile launcher reload time, which makes these rapid launchers reload quite a bit faster, in 24 seconds instead of 35 seconds or something like that. I can't remember what the base is, but having the faster reload is extremely nice with these rapid torpedoes. Makes life a little bit better. And then so for the fit, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 mid slots, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 low slots, and then 5 highs. For the rigs, we got a cap safeguard and then 2 riggers, and then we have 3 rapid torpedo launchers, a siege module, and a smart bomb. We have a Concord shield booster. This can be meta or lower. This can actually be a much cheaper booster if you want. This can be tech 2, but I went with C-type. This can be tech 2, but I went with C-type. We have 2 FRX cap boosters. I have a Republic Fleet target painter. This can also be tech 2, but I went with the Pithamex type. Again, it's a dread. May as well spend a little bit of ISK on it. We have 2 polybolus ballistics control systems, and then one Republic Fleet ballistics control system, a missile guidance enhancer. And then I prefer DCU, but what you can do is you can put a 3rd polybolus, or you can put a Republic Fleet ballistics control system, depending on if you want more damage or application. Alternatively, you can put another guidance enhancer, and then after flying with it for a site, I'm debating whether we need 2 application modifiers, being a Fed Navy Web and a target painter. I'm not sure if we need both. We could take one off for a different modifier, or have, instead of having this, we could have like a ballistics control script. But this is things that all, they don't stack against each other. So all the riggers don't stack with the target painter, and then the Federation web is separate from that. So it's kind of nice. It helps with the application a little bit. Once we're siege, we get 4,500 DPS and 3,500 if we factor in reloads, which is pretty nutty. This fit does require a power grid implant of 1%. So I threw 20 in the ship because I know it's a like million-esque implant. I'll just throw them away rather than trying to worry about keeping them. Our crab appears to have been dropped, and it's been up for a minute. But that's enough about the Phoenix hull itself and the fitting. This thing is surprisingly effective at killing the NPCs. I was actually really pleased with it. In the hangar, we carry our drugs, we carry cap boosters. In the fleet hangar, we carry extra cap boosters. And in fuel, we have Strant and Nitros. Nitros allow us to jump out and stuff. We're going to conserve fuel as much as possible as far as the siege module goes, because we only have 1,000 Strant, and I think the last site I did took a little over 900. So we're going to be kind of cutting it close. So I'm going to siege right here at the last second, just before we actually start doing anything. And unfortunately, the ship doesn't have a cool siege animation. The little things are going to slide, and that's about it that's going to happen. anyways, we're going to go ahead and target paint the first target and hit it for hopefully full damage. And it should take 10,000 damage. And it just gets torn apart by the missiles. We're smart bombing this guy right now because it will reduce the amount of fire that we have to do after the battleship dies, which the battleship is going to die on the next volley that hits it. We should go there. And then we're going to go ahead and help the Mu die with the torpedoes. And it works really effectively. You really don't need a smart bomb, but it's nice to have. At this point, we're going to go ahead and reload. We reload between every wave. If there's nothing on grid, you always just control R. Reload. That's how I found this ship to be the most effective. That way we try and clear a wave without reloading and we get access to the full 4,500 DPS rather than eating reload DPS because reload DPS kind of sucks. So I was pretty impressed. We're in a slightly lower system. We have about 8 to 10% less BRM compared to where we were able to test the Revelation. And that we our big tick was 92 and our first tick was 86. And then I got paid out from the ESS right afterwards. So total, I made, what would that be? Just over 200 million-esque in bounties in roughly 25, 30 minutes. And then I got the payout from the crab since they're pretty cheap right now. The crab ended up paying out 200 something million-esque, which was really nice. We actually ended up having a really good time with the amount of bounty that we got on our first run. And we're going to verify that data here. So I'm just Xing out some things here. So it does very similarly bounty wise to the Revelation. And the Revelation had a staggeringly high bounty of roughly 110 million for peak bounty, which is really good. And if we realize that we're in a slightly lower DPS, and it was my first time flying the ship, so I hadn't figured out any of the optimizations yet, that's actually really impressive. So I was really happy with the bounties that this thing earns. And then managing its shields and its repairs is a little bit easier. The tip that I have is to turn the auto repeat off on your booster and use it as needed. You want to boost when your shields are at or around 70% because that's how much you rep in a cycle. And then if you just don't over boost, the cap is in a super good spot. We'll saturate right around 55 or so percent cap is where we'll balance out, and we won't need the cap injectors unless we get put under duress, which is really nice, like extremely, really nice. And the ship should only get put under duress when it's tackled. And I just saw myself in local there and I thought myself in local was in neutral. I gave myself a little heart attack. But yeah, the Phoenix is a really neat ship. It uses nitrogen isotopes to jump around. It's a Kaldari ship. And one big bonus to being a torpedo ship for anti-crabs is that it uses the torpedo skill for its weapons rather than a capital skill. So torpedoes takes only 20 days to train to level 5, whereas the capital skills take like 35 days. So it's 15 days easier to train than the other dreads. So not only is it the easiest dread to train into because it doesn't need to train the capital guns, but it is among the best of the four for doing crabs. I'm not sure if it's better than the Moros, but I can definitely say it's better than the Revelation and the Neglifer with the experience that I've had so far. We still have to do the solo Neglifer video. I've done a solo crab with a Neglifer. It's not quite as pretty, but we still do have to do that video. The Rev and the Phoenix are definitely the top dogs of this content. I did not think that the Phoenix would be as good as it is. We cleared the first beacon in like 25 minutes, and this beacon is very empty, actually. We've had like zero spawns, which is kind of weird. I'm gonna go ahead and drop siege. Oh, well, I have to re-siege. I was gonna drop siege for a second to attempt to save a little fuel. And just as I spoke about there not being NPCs, here they are to cause us issues. I'm just gonna throw the ship back in siege. One of these guys is Newts, and I believe it's this one, so I'm gonna hit him first. with everything I've got. And he is going to go melty melt. This is actually almost as fast as a super for killing the NPCs, but it's not quite as fast as a super. The super has a lot of alpha, which is really nice, and it two-shots these guys, which is insane. But it clears them really fast, so you don't end up with as many bounties. And how that ends up working is if you clear the beacon faster, you will get less total waves if you kill the NPCs too fast. And if you kill them a little bit slower, you'll be killing the wave that came in when the next wave is coming in the next time. And that makes it a, that means that you're going to end up with more bounty payout, but you're going to get less crab payouts. And the crab payouts range from 50 million to like 700 million. I've heard of people getting some really fancy things in there, upwards towards a billion-esque, which is really awesome if you get that, but it's pretty rare. So the big debate with crabs is really, are they better to stretch and run longer and get the bounties? Or are they better just power crab through as many of the beacons as you can? They recently reduced beacon costs, which leads me to believe that they want people power crabbing. But the downside of power crabbing and killing a lot of beacons in rapid succession is you can only drop 3 per character. So if you don't have capital alts, which is a pretty high demand for a lot of content, you are going to be limited to running 3 of these per day. And if you're doing them in 20 minutes, that's an hour-long session where you're going to run right out of crabs. So like if you have a super on grid and you run them in 30 minutes, an hour and a half, and you're going to be done. Whereas if you have a dread and it takes you 40 minutes to clear a crab, you now get to crab for nearly 3 hours, depending on if you have to go back to station and refuel and all that. So it's kind of nice to understand kind of the difference between running like a super and a dread. And then, of course, comparing Dreadnought to Super is not apples to apples, because the Super is significantly safer due to the fact, I think we explained this in the Super video, where they can actually get reps outside of Siege, whereas a Dreadnought is stuck Sieged, and once it's Sieged, it cannot receive remote aid. People can show up and clear DPS off of it, but it's if something comes that can actually kill it, it's probably going to die. Because a dread will die in less than a siege cycle with Kikis or something on it. Like, there's not much you can do to save it, even with the best stuff in the game. So that's just kind of a thing with dreads. But they are significantly cheaper than supers. This hole in fit cost me roughly 7 billion-esque, and a super costs roughly 40. So it's the big difference in cost. And for similar income, and you just kind of soak up the risk, you can lose 3 or 4 of these instead of one super. That might be worth it, depending on how many crabs you run and how much of a power crab you are. It just kind of depends on your personal preference. But this thing just absolutely is shredding these NPCs. Looks like we're on reload again. So fortunately with my fit, we can actually reach these Taos. And one thing I want to talk about missiles is if we open up the fitting here and then hit info on the charges. This is really interesting stuff. But missiles work not like guns. So they have a flight time of 11.45 seconds and the velocity of 5,900 meters. So we'll just say 5,900 for ease, and we'll say 11.5 for ease of math here. But how this ends up working is very counterintuitive. You would think that you would just multiply these numbers together and you would get a range. And that's actually what the little tooltip does here. It calculates, it multiplies those two numbers and gives you a range. However, what ends up happening is because the server only functions in whole seconds at a time, we have a chance that, and this is going to sound really weird, but we have a chance that a missile flies for 12 seconds and a chance that the missile flies for 11. So our guaranteed range is going to be 5.9 times 11, which is about 65. We'll just say it's 65 to 5,900, 6,400 meters is the guaranteed range. And then the missile can decide to fly an extra second, which about 55% will fly for 45 seconds, or for not 45 seconds, for 12 seconds, and then the other 55% will fly for our 11 seconds. So that's why the range varies, and why missile flight times are inaccurate in this little tooltip. And it's something that's really helpful to know for both capital and sub-capital pilots when figuring out what they're doing with their ranges. So I thought that that'd be a little helpful tidbit. We learned this when doing burners with the Garmer, because the Garmer has a, it's not a 1.5, it's a 3 second flight time. And that's with all of its bonuses and stuff, and all like the ballistics controls and the way we have it set up. It's got an exactly a 3 second flight time with the optimal anti-team setup. And what that means is if your skills aren't trained and you have a 2.5 second flight time, you're only going to do half your damage. So having that closer to a whole second means that your damage representation is going to be far more accurate, which is really helpful for a lot of reasons. This crab beacon is very lethargic with NPCs. We're already down to 4 minutes. That, or we're just killing them very quickly, and that's what happens when you kill them very quickly. You end up with some really nice bounties and a fairly short crab beacon, which is kind of nice, but then having to anchor another beacon is unfortunate. All right, so we are going to go ahead and lock all these bad boys up and keep an eye on our strunt. And just going to laugh at the application that this thing has. It's rather silly. This wave has nothing that hangs out really far, so it's going to be a really quick wave. These two nudes hang out around 40. So as you guys can see, I've been using rage torpedoes the entire time, and we haven't had to switch off of rage, which is super convenient. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. And the torpedoes just, they hit the target really hard. We're having some fancy missiles with this new. They're floating around space. And if I was really good at this, I'd be counting targets, or I'd be counting shots and doing this actually the right way. But I haven't learned how many shots each NPC takes to kill yet. I have learned that the torpedoes are extremely effective at killing them, though. And that is actually kind of awesome. And I'm pretty impressed with this. So for both the Revelation and the Phoenix, my spaceship command skill is trained to 4, because level 5 dreadnought skills is like a 50-day thing. I will be getting the skills to 5 in the future, and we'll do a revisit of all the dreads once I have all the dread skills to 5. But with it to 4, this thing is really, really doing extremely well. And the fact that we don't need to train the Tech 2 weapons for it is honestly a huge bonus for rapid torpedoes. And the sheer DPS, even with reload, is 3,500, which is what our DPS was with the Revelation. And we're closer to the 4,500 DPS when things are on grid, because we're reloading between waves. And that's a really strong strategy, honestly. It seems to be working very well. We've only had to do one reload with NPCs on grid. So we're effectively running 4,500 DPS, as long as we don't have to reload. But if we do have to reload it, the average goes down. And it just, it's, this thing is honestly silly. A frigate? No, that's a cruiser. I'm gonna knock this guy out because he takes extra missiles. I honestly don't know. Maybe some of you guys can count the number of hits each target takes in the video, and then post a comment and tell me what my counts are. That way I can count missiles and do this really effectively. Or I could watch the VOD and figure out the counts. But for every pilot, the count's going to be a little bit different. depending on your skills, your missile flight times, and your exact fit, because your fit may deviate from mine, as mine's not the official fit. So mine's a fit that I looked for inspiration from the horde fits, but this is my fit. This is not an official fitting of anybody's. So I looked for inspiration from them, and it is very similar to their fit, but it's got a little bit of my own flavor, so to speak. So it looks like we're going to be reloading here. And I'm going to have to reload in order to kill this Omicron. So I'm just going to go ahead and reload now since we're waiting on locking anyways. And being a 24 second reload, it's kind of steep with the rapid torps, but putting standard torpedoes on this thing is not worth it because the rate of fire is just way too slow. And it only gets, I believe, bonuses to the rapids and not the standards. It looks like we got another one coming. So the reload was a really good choice to do. And nuke him. And 10,000 damage hit, man. I love seeing 10,000 damage. The one big downside to missiles is they can't hit smashing or critical hits. So they don't do like double damage sometimes. They always do the same damage to the same NPCs because it's the NPC's motion and his statistics largely that have impact on the application and the damage you do. And that's why missiles are generally recommended for new players, because you don't have to worry about what exactly your ship is doing relative to their ship. You just have to worry about what their ship is doing in order to get good application. And the only thing you need to know is how fast it's moving. Go ahead and reload right here. And like I said, 20 minutes, 30 minutes to run a crab and a phoenix. That's absolutely insane. It's just awesome. So we got another tick. We got 87 million ISK, and then we got 54 in the bank. The bank was empty when we started it. So that was a really, really nice tick. Actually quite enjoyed seeing that number. 86 million ISK on the first tick is really good. I think we got something similar in the Revelation. But the crab was nowhere near as progressed, if that makes sense. So having a not we're not going to get a second full tick. And I'll be able to give you guys numbers on the first crab that I got. We'll do some math because I did one crab, so we can do some math and figure out about how much the crab made total as soon as we finish this crab. So this crab's got a minute and a half left. I'm kind of looking at my siege timer, thinking about if I want to get out of siege or not, and I'm tempted to red cycle. But we're probably not going to be able to red cycle here. Not yet. We've probably got one more cycle of siege left. We're keeping an eye on our Strant. It's nice to have an alt to deliver additional Strant if you need it. Or cap boosters if you need them, because dreads run out of Strant very quickly. They don't really carry or don't really have enough storage in there. I guess you could put a bunch in the fleet hangar. That's probably what I'll start doing. But I have millions of Strant, and just a matter of how heavy it is and getting the Strant actually in the ship. The tanking on the ship is a little bit easier than on the Revelation because you don't have to kind of guesstimate. Am I halfway through armor? Like, do I rep now? Because the reps happen on the front half of the cycle rather than the back half. So if you hit the booster, it immediately gives you the result and you can kind of think, do I want to run in another cycle? Well, it's cycling. Making it a really, really easy ship to manage capacitor-wise and all that. As you've noticed, I haven't touched my cap boosters this entire site, and we're still floating roughly 62% cap, which is phenomenal. So just a matter of, oh, I'm gonna go ahead and stop firing at this guy now and lock this guy up. I think I threw enough missiles. Yeah, if one more missile's in the air, it'll kill that. I'm just gonna throw one more just to be safe. That missile should hit the target. Yeah, sure did. And now we're hitting the Omicron here. We're definitely gonna want to siege one more cycle. Believe a siege cycle is 5 minutes, and it uses up a total of 125. Yep, so I think we're gonna red cycle. here, and that will lead us to the end of the crab. We have a minute and 30 seconds left, and in the 2 minutes, we cleared 30 seconds. So we might have one more cycle, we might have two more cycles, but this Phoenix is smashing. Now we're going to go ahead and reload here. I should have reloaded a little bit sooner, but that's okay. It's a me mistake, and that happens when you're learning a ship. But at the end of a wave, if there's nothing else on grid, you should reload your Phoenix because of its significantly long reload cycle. All right, we got 60 seconds left. I'm probably going to red cycle this. So when you red cycle the siege module, it turns off, and then you have to reactivate it, which you can forget to do and do like no damage. And that's just kind of unfortunate when that happens. So this crab was a bit shorter than the last one, so I don't think I'm going to make as much in bounties, because I think I got 86 and 96 last time. This summer I'm probably going to get in the ballpark of 86 and like 40, because this beacon's going to expire, and I'm not going to get a whole lot of bounties from it, which is okay. But it was a nice quick beacon, and it made for a good video. Maybe we'll just get the endless wave here. So what we could do is we could leave an NPC alive and we could stretch this beacon now that it has 15 seconds left. And I started recording just prior to it, so I could stretch this beacon very easily with this kind of setup. And we could make this beacon last longer if we really wanted to. But I don't want to keep you guys here forever. And I don't want want these videos to be something that you guys can consume without, you know, taking up your whole day. I don't want to take up that kind of time on you guys, if that makes sense. I don't know if you guys appreciate longer videos where I just kind of crab and talk about things, or if you guys like the shorter videos where I talk about something a little bit more specific and then give you guys like a quick guide. But I'm trying to mix it up and do a little bit of both to keep everybody happy. So that guy's dead. We're going to go ahead and work on Tao. Remember, Tao's out there. And missiles have flight time, so they're going to sit up in space. Look at him, and we can see the missiles hit or not make it to the target. So there's the first one hit, second one hit, and they're hitting at different times than when I fired. Where guns are instant, because they have no travel, the guns are not instant for the ship. What? Is it just like not hitting? Yep, so some are hitting, some are not. It must have to do with his speed. That makes sense. I'm going to go ahead and reload, or not reload and repair from that wave. One more cycle there. That was overkill, but we're all repaired now. And the Tau died, and we're reloaded. We're ready for the next wave. It looks like this thing sips on ammo. It doesn't use ammo very quickly, which means it's cheap to run and operate. And then strontium, I know, sounds expensive, but honestly, it's a really cheap material that you can get in mass fairly easily. And this crab beacon is done. It looks like we got 202 million ISK out of the crab. And we got a little bonus spawn here, which we're going to go ahead and use a smart bomb. We're going to red cycle this, as we should be done dealing with all these NPCs before the cycle's over, and we're unlikely to get another wave. So I'm just going to do as much damage as I can, as quickly as I can, to these NPCs. Because they're only going to be here for 2 more minutes. And our beacon looks to have another minute. Or not our beacon, our siege cycle looks to have 1 more minute here. That's dead, and then we start throwing at the Tau. Smart bombs will kill the vector. And then once this siege cycle expires, our DPS goes down to like 20. So it's really bad for our DPS output. But we know from the revelation that a smart bomb will deal with the frigate. And it's not an issue. And that smart bomb will probably kill the frigate on its own. Looks like our siege cycle is over. I killed that guy. and probably poke a couple torps at him. And he died. And the crab's gonna blow up. So that's a crab beacon in a phoenix. So I'll go ahead and give you guys some numbers. We got a very similar, what you would call it, from the first one. But our first crab beacon gave us 86 plus 93. We'll go ahead and go to calculator. We'll try and do this a little bit more accurately. So we got 86 plus 93 plus 113 equals 292. We got another 200 out of the beacon. We made about, oops. Did I? 113 plus, and 113 plus 93 plus 86. And then minus the cost of the crab, we'll say it's 75. We made about 400 million-esque on a single crab, which is insane. And then this crab isn't going to make 400 million-esque, but that's kind of nuts for 25 to 30 minutes making 400 million-esque. I'm going to go ahead and go back to my tether here. And if you guys like this video and enjoy this content, do let me know. If we get enough pressure, we may be able to stream it on Twitch sometime, but that is hard pressed because Sieging the Dread has it's got a cycle time. And if I'm streaming this, you guys can see the cycle times and you guys can just come in when I'm starting a cycle if I'm streaming it, so you can guarantee the kill. Whereas if I'm not streaming, there's a chance that you come in, the cycle's almost over and I get saved. So streaming this isn't ideal. And then there's a couple of other issues with streaming that streaming this content that I'm just not going to get into. But that's why you guys don't see me doing crabs on stream as often. As much as I love doing them, they are not streaming friendly. They're definitely YouTube friendly, and you guys love seeing them on YouTube. Speaking of which, I'm going to take a screenshot here for the thumbnail. But make sure you guys fly fun, enjoy your time, and continue bringing each other up. And I will see you guys in the next video, stream, or in Dota, because we've been playing some Dota recently. But yeah, I'll see you guys in the next one.